How's it going, everybody? My name is Scott Moss. I've been an engineer for over 10 years, and currently I'm a tech investor. And in this course, you're gonna learn how to build AI-powered apps in Node.js. Now I get it, AI can seem daunting to get started, but I'm here to tell you it's actually not that bad. And I'll be walking you through some really crucial exercises with AI. I'm talking building semantic search, document QA, chat interfaces, and even something super powerful like function calling. And by the end of the course, you should feel pretty comfortable to go on and build AI-powered features in your Node.js applications. So let's send a message. We're gonna say, role user, right? So user, and then we'll send a message that says, or I'm sorry, content that says like, you know, hi. We'll do that. We'll say hi. Okay. And then what we want to do is we just want to get the response back from this. And we'll save this in a variable. I'll just say results equals await this. So if you're on version 18 of Node, which you should be, you can do top level await. If you're wondering like, how am I doing await not inside of an async? You can do this at the root of a file now without having to be in an async function if you're on the latest version of Node. So I'm just gonna await that. And then I think we'll just log this for now so you can kind of see what's coming back and then we'll talk about it. So let's do that. And then, yeah, let's see if we broke something or not. So now we'll just say Node index, we'll run that. And you can see this is what I get back. I get back an ID, you know, some really cool stuff. The two things that you really want to look at are one, the usage. So this is how many tokens my prompt has. You can think of a token, basically, I think it averages out to like every 3 or 4 characters. You can kind of think of it as like softly as like a token is a word. It's not a character. It's not like every character is a token. It's on average like 3 to 4 characters, you know, maybe a word. So you can see I had like 29 tokens. And then the completion tokens are the tokens in which the AI responded back with. So how many tokens it had. And then you combine them all. These are the total tokens. And at least for OpenAI, ChatGPT, you get charged on how many tokens you are generating because that is a linear cost for them. However many tokens their system has to generate, that's more compute that they're charged for. That's more electricity. That's more time. So they charge you for that. They basically pass that cost on. So the more tokens you have as a prompt and the more completion tokens that are sent back, that's how you are charged on a token basis. So there are products out there that like help you figure out how to maintain this cost, how to like make a router that sends specific prompts to specific AIs that are optimized for specific token costs. It's crazy. It gets really nuts. So you got that. But the other thing is the choices. And this is where the AI responds. So let's actually take a look at that. So I'm going to log results.choices, (0). Let's run that again. And you can see I get back an object. It has a message. And you can see role is assistant. I mean, this is the AI talking now. Role assistant. And then content, hello, how can I assist you today? And then finish reason is stop. That just means it had nothing else to say. Like, I'm done talking to you. This is important later when we talk about functions because sometimes it's not finished. It might respond and it might not be done because either A, it hit a context, like it hit the limit of which it can respond as far as a token limit, and or it needs you to do something in your code before it can continue and provide more context. So it might not always be done even though it responded. And that's where it can get pretty tricky. If you ever use ChatGPT, there's a button that says like, or sometimes it will stop halfway through the generation. You have to say, keep going. This is it. Like it hit a limit on how much it can respond with, but yet it's not done yet. So pretty cool stuff. But anyway, yeah, so we get that back. So if we just log that, .message.content, and then we can just change this. So you can be like, you know, hi, you know, can you tell me what is the best way to learn how to do maths? I don't know. Let's see what it says. Oh, there it is. So you can see the more tokens it needed to respond with, the longer it took. This is why the cost goes up because that is a cost for them, right? So what we're gonna do is return store.similarity search. We can actually even do like a similarity search with a score, which will like return them ranked by how relative they were to the query. So that's useful. So you can like sort them on your UI to be like, this is the one that's most likely versus not. So like, you know, you can do whatever you want there. We're just gonna do a similarity search. We're gonna pass in a query. And then, you know, how many at most we want back. So what the similarity search is gonna do, it's gonna convert this query into an embedding, just like this is an embedding. It's gonna perform that cosine similarity search to see if these embeddings, which one of these embeddings are closest to this embedding. And it's going to return all the matching documents that are closest to that. Does that make sense? Okay. Cool. And then the last thing we need to do is just search anything here, right? So let's try that. So I'll go on the next line. I'll say console.log. I'm going to await my search. And then let's search for something. So we got some movies here. I want to a movie that will make me feel like I am crazy. I want something that's gonna make me feel like I'm crazy, right? That's the type of movie I wanna find. I'm in for that. I want one of those, because actually I do like movies that make me feel like I'm crazy. Those are like some of the best movies. So if this works, let's try to run it. So we'll say search. And you see I get back Shutter Island. Yeah, that movie's definitely gonna make you feel absolutely insane, right? And you can see here's the metadata associated with it and here's the title, right? Like, how did it know that? Well, I mean, it says it's a mind-bending plot. So yeah, that's probably gonna make you feel crazy, right? So let's try another one. I have Paw Patrol in here, right? So if I wanna say like, oh, you know, something cute and fluffy, right? Something cute and fluffy, I don't think I mentioned that anywhere in here. There's nothing cute and fluffy. I mean, there's adorable. There's no word of cute.
Adorable puppies.
Anywhere, right? Just puppies, right? So let's see. I would imagine Paw Patrol is gonna come back because all the other movies are like pretty intense in that list. Yeah, Paw Patrol does come back. All right. That's pretty cool. Like you could not make something like this. I don't know, just 2 years ago, this simple. Like it's just very simple to be able to do that. And again, remember, at its core, we're just comparing numbers together. That's it. These things get turned into numbers. This query gets turned into numbers. And we're seeing which group of numbers are closest to this group of numbers when we plot them out. DALL-E generates images, right? ChatGPT just got released with DALL-E support. How do you think they did it? They did this. They just made a function in here that says like, you know, generate image. And it takes in a prompt. Right, and then it just calls the DALL-E API, which I mean we could try it. Let's see. Let's see what happens. We can say result equals await OpenAI dot images dot generate. What does this take? Does this take a prompt? I don't even know what this thing takes. Body. I think it takes like that thing. Yeah, okay. So you can do that. I don't know what the result's gonna be. Let's just log it. Cool, and then I'll just respond back with like nothing for now. So then I can do that, right? And then I can take this whole object here, make a new one. Okay, it didn't copy the way that I thought it was going to. I'll just do the whole thing.
One more bracket down.
Yeah. There we go. So I can call this create image. I'll just give this the same name too. Or generate image. Okay, let's do that. Generate image. And this is a create or generate image based on a description, right? And then I'll take a prompt. It's a string. And I want to the description of the image to generate. And then this needs to be prompt. There we go. So I don't know, this might work. Let's see. So then now I can go down here and I can say, I want an image, or create me an image of a cat flying through space. See what happens. I don't know what that is. It looks like it just tried to create some markdown. Oh, there it is. Oh, it did it. Damn. It actually, I was not expecting that. Let's go see it. Wow. It's kind of crazy. It just responded back with markdown because obviously I didn't respond back with the image, right? Like I just put an empty string here. So it's like, I don't know how to respond back, but we logged it, right? So kind of.
So it's generating that prompt, which is just text that it's then passing to it. So is it pulling the exact same prompt that you gave, or is it creating its own prompt based on?
That's a good question. Let's see.
Yeah.
Let's check it out. So let's look at the prompt that it sent in. I don't know. I put temperature on zero, so I'm guessing it's the exact same thing. If I change the temperature, I bet it'll get crazier. So let's log the prompt. And actually, let me send back the result. What was the result? It was an object with the data in an array. Let's send that back so that way it can respond back with it. So result dot data bracket zero dot URL. There we go. Let's try that. So same thing. Get an image of cat flying through space. Yeah, the prompt was a cat flying through space. And yeah, here's what it got back. Yeah.